Let's all welcome Shreya Sachdev, who is head of marketing and strategy of Puma India. Shreya, how are you doing? Before we jump into
Very
the
good.
main part of the conversation.
Doing very good. Very much looking forward to today's session. I think it's going to be a fun one.
Definitely. I mean, you are there, it has to be, no? So, Shreya, let's start the conversation with how your journey with Puma India started.
Sure. So I think I love telling people this, and I think if there's anybody in the audience who's heard this before, they'll smile. But I think my favorite thing to always tell people is, that typically the people that you meet are either very much right-brained or very much left-brained. But I've always been this person who's been, sort of equally right-brained and left-brained. So I love structured problem-solving. I love working with data, but I also love creative execution. And I think everything that I've really done to this point has been about really finding that balance. So I started with my undergrad at LSR, where I did a degree in literature. And I did a couple of design internships, built my love for fashion over the years, followed by an MBA at I'm Lucknow. Then I worked at McKinsey as a consultant for a few years. And then, of course, joined Puma in 2019. And I think, right now, the role that I'm doing, which is both marketing and strategy, I would say in a lot of ways is a perfect fit because I think it's that culmination of that search for something that is challenging both from a left brain as well as right brain perspective. I think what sets Puma apart and why I feel I fit in so well here is I think Puma India is probably that only organization where, and I love saying this again, is that you get all the perks of an MNC, but the culture of a startup, right? Because you're working with a bunch of really young, really passionate people. We're all about fast decision making. We've built our success on this idea of risk taking. We are constantly looking for, what's the next innovation to go after. So I think in a lot of senses, again, it works for somebody like me because I enjoy a fast-paced work culture. I enjoy the freedom, to take risks. We're constantly looking to do the next new thing. And so I think in a lot of ways, I would say that the current role at Puma is a perfect fit to who I am as a person. And I think the journey was extremely inspiring for me as well. So I don't know how many people know, but Puma entered the market around 2006, which is about 10 years later than all of our other competitors in the sports and lifestyle space. And in just a matter of 8 years, we've become the number one sports and lifestyle brand in India. And I think it's a testament to, all of these things that I said. Risk-taking, constant, focus on innovation, a bunch of really young, passionate people, who work, very closely with each other to drive, the next chapter of growth. And so I think it's, like I said, it's been fantastic. It's been about 2 years, almost. I joined in Jan of 2019. And I think it's been a very fantastic, very chaotic journey. And it doesn't feel like 2 years. It feels like 10 years because so much has happened in this 2 year space. But it's been absolutely fantastic.
I'm sure, and I just noticed one important element from your, like when you're briefing about yourself, your interest towards fashion, right? That has also been
It
there.
definitely was.
And I think like Puma has the best combination.
Absolutely. I think we're not just a sports brand. I think we call ourselves both a sports and a lifestyle brand. And I think that very much sort of reflects in both our products and channel strategy as well as our marketing. I think we have successfully managed to position ourselves both as a credible sports brand, but also very much as a youthful, fresh, fashion-oriented brand as well.
Yeah, definitely. And yeah, that's the agenda of our conversation today. The reason why, I mean, how Puma came with this staggering growth, which is like incredible. So, Shreya, moving on to the next part of the conversation, that we all have noticed that women have been the driving force behind Puma India's success and growth. And we have like Marie Kom, we have Beauty Chand, apart from like the Kohli, obviously. But how does brand campaigns like Proper Lady influence the sales in terms of like if I talk about hardcore sales?
So I think first to answer your point on women, right? I think not just the strong female ambassadors that we hire, but I think Puma as an organization as well is probably one of the most gender equal organizations that you will see today. And I think in my past life, I've worked with a bunch of organizations. I think Puma by far has the best gender ratio. And I think the reason why really that is because I think unlike a lot of other organizations, we don't really chase gender ratio as a goal. So I don't think anybody at Puma would say, let's hire more women, right? And that's probably one of the worst things you can do for gender ratio. I think we at Puma realized early on that really diversity of perspectives has been and will continue to be critical to our success. And if you need to ensure and foster that diversity of thought process and perspectives, then you need to ensure that the ecosystem that your employees are working in is extremely accommodating and flexible and brings out the best in literally every employee that you hire, right? And so you will see, we probably have like more than a 40% gender ratio in corporate. I think the leadership team itself is evenly split. And you'll see a lot of women in, leadership roles that are traditionally thought to be not suitable for women, right? So our head of operations and warehousing is a woman, our CFO is a woman, right? And really, I think that reflects then in campaigns like Proper Lady, right? Because you have a bunch of extremely smart, hardworking, capable, confident, baller women who are sitting together in a room and saying, what do we want to say to all of the women out there, right? As a brand, and what do we stand for? And I think that really reflects in a campaign like Proper Lady, because I think what really made it successful was how relevant the message was, right? I mean, I think we all at Puma, I think all of us women are extremely tired of hearing that we need to be empowered, right? And I think we realize that, well, women exist in a space that is inherently unequal, and they yet continue to go out there and do brilliant things, right? I mean, look at Mary, look at Dhuti. They've overcome all sorts of odds to be where they are. And nobody had to tell them to be empowered, right? They just went out there and did their thing. And I think Proper Lady was really about that. It was really celebrating these women who, despite all odds, go out there and really kick ass every day. And I think that's really what makes campaigns like Proper Lady really successful. I think it's because we as a brand spend a lot of time internalizing the messaging that we want to give out to our consumers. And the fact that you have a lot of women who are sitting there every day and saying, hey, what do we as women care about and what do we as a brand stand for? That very much reflects in the campaigns that we do. And of course, I will talk about sales in a moment. Okay, I think somebody says the voice is breaking. Let me pull the earphone a little clearer, closer, and see if that works better. All right, let's hope this works.
No, I think, sorry to interrupt, Shreya. What you can do is if it's a wired earphone, then you can take it out and put it back again. That will help.
No, these are Bluetooth earphones, so I don't think that's the issue. Could be a network issue. Is it problematic for you as well?
A bit slightly.
okay okay let me try putting
Okay,
the
guys, just
earphones closer.
put in the comment section if you can hear Shreya properly.
Okay, let me know if this is better now or is it still breaking. Okay, super. No,
Okay,
okay.
okay, okay. We are getting mixed opinion on this.
All right, let me do something. Let me see if I can speak a bit slower. And maybe then that'll help.
You can try taking off the Bluetooth, says Devika.
I'll struggle a bit because there's a lot of ambient noise. Okay, it's better. Okay, let me try speaking slower and seeing.
It's better, Shreya.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, super. Okay, so then we'll stick to this one. All right.
Yeah.
Super. Yeah, so I was talking about Proper Lady, right? I think overnight we saw a huge jump in the percentage of women followers on social. I think we also, of course, saw a huge contribution from the women's business, go up for us. But I think also what was extremely, heartening for us is anybody that you speak to today, right? Any woman that you speak to, whether it's campuses that you give a talk on or, an interview that you're doing to hire somebody, or just generally people that you speak to, right? I think if there is one thing that women remember and that resonates for them when they connect Puma is the Proper Lady campaign, and I think that is really the cornerstone of the success of a campaign like Proper Lady, because of course sales and followership is a combination of a bunch of things, but when all of the women that you wanted to reach out to and say something important to remember your message and it resonates with them and they bring it up again and again, I think that's really how I would define success of a campaign like that. But of course, marketing doesn't exist for just marketing sake. I think it exists to very much drive business objectives. And we saw, a growth in the contribution of women's business after that for sure. So I think on all planes, it was, a very successful campaign.
That's incredible. And see, it has a lot more social impact. I mean, business is at one place, definitely, but then the encouragement towards a woman coming forward and eventually buying a product which is like into fitness and lifestyle, that's a different kind of liberty, probably.
No, I think very much. I think we as a brand definitely would, of course, we stand for fitness and we stand for fashion, but I think with Proper Lady, we wanted to stand for much, much more, right? It's not just about selling our products. It's really saying, hey, we celebrate all women out there, anybody who's, managing a job and a house and still managing to keep fit, chasing her dreams, going out there, putting herself out there every day. I think it was really very much about that, right? It was talking to every woman out there who, despite all odds, still manages to go out there and kick ass, really. This was a celebration of all of those women.
Yeah, great. So let's move on from Proper Lady campaign, because Puma has come up with so many result-oriented campaigns. We will talk about a lot more. So now we all know that Virat Kohli has the impact on Puma. I mean, Virat Kohli is like the Virat Kohli, the brand. So, but has there been a similar appeal from footballers? Like we have Sunil Chhetri with Puma and we have Gurpreet Singh Sandhu as well. So how has it been, if I may ask?
Sure. So I think as a sports brand, I think it's very important to work with people who lend credibility to the brand and help us build further on that credibility that we've built, right? And I think as the best and biggest sports brand in the country, I think we would want to work with the best athletes out there, right? And somebody like Sunil Chhetri is it, right? Captain of the football team, second highest goal scorer in the world. I think he pretty much epitomizes that credibility in sports that we as a brand would want to stand for. And it's not just about the followers that he has or the fans that he has, which of course he has in abundance. But I think it's very much about the credibility also that he brings to the table, right? And his career that has, spanned years, he's truly an icon, in that sense. Everything that he does and says makes news. And so I think just the fact that he's on the Puma team, he's part of the Puma family itself, lends a lot of credibility and weight to us as a sports brand. That being said, of course, you know, everything he does, you know, of course, adds value to us as a brand. I don't know whether you saw recently, but we did an IG live with a bunch of people from the Puma family, right? And Sunil Chhetri was one of them. And his conversation with Virat, of course, went live, right? Because here you had two captains who were who are very much icons in their own space, right? Having an interesting conversation that went, that covered sports, but so much more as well, right? So in a lot of ways, I think we're seeing, you know, working with extremely credible athletes as, you know, as core to what we stand for as a sports brand.
True. In fact, that IG's live session was, that's something which is very different for the audience as well, right? Mm-hmm. Like having, right. And that conversation was very candid. That's what I really liked about that right. conversation between Kohli and Chhetri. So let's let's talk about Puma's positioning into the world of sneakers, okay? And if you see, the sneaker culture is all about carving a unique brand entity. And there are like hardcore sneaker fans. I have seen them. So how has Puma established a strong hold in sneakers being such a competitive market?
Sure. So I think, you know, one of the things that we often hear about Indian consumers is, oh, they're, you know, very much price conscious. This is a value driven market, right? And when we released the RS in, you know, 2019, I think this was one of the things on our mind, right? Because the RS is a 10,000 rupee shoe. It's not a performance shoe, right? It's very much a, you know, a lifestyle sneaker, right? In that sense, very much, you know, something that somebody who's invested in the sneaker culture would focus on, right? And we were worried about, you know, how well it would do, right? And I think one of the things that really, I think, pleasantly surprised us was that RS turned out to be one of our highest sellers for the year, right? And I think in that sense, it really broke all stereotypes about the Indian market and what Indian consumers weren't and were ready for. And I think, you know, athleisure is pretty much having its moment right now, right? Globally, but also in India, I think we are seeing a huge pickup in the athleisure trend, and that pretty much reflects in the sales of products that we do as well, right? So whether it's an RS or, you know, the Masaba collection that we launched last year that sold out in 48 hours, I think Indian consumers are increasingly, you know, becoming more and more invested in the athleisure culture. And I think the key to cultivating this sneaker culture is the same as pretty much any consumer segment that you would really target. It's about understanding who your consumer is, what really, you know, interests them, and then, you know, talking to them about that. I think, you know, as marketers, we tend to believe that we have, you know, the strongest channel of communication with our consumers. But the truth is, a lot of times, traditional marketing is pretty much one-way communication, right? So you have a brand that says, well, this is what I want to say. And if you're interested, then, you know, you can hear me out. And I think at Puma, we're moving away from that concept of, hey, this is what we want to say, to, hey, what do you want to talk about, right? And we'll talk about that. And I think it's important with a cohort like sneaker, like sneakerheads, or with pretty much any cohort that, you know, Puma targets, it's important to understand who your consumer is, what is important to them, right? And then build your communication or your campaigns based on that. So I think that's really the key to how we have been focusing on this segment. Of course, great products are a key to that, right? You can't really sell bad products. So we, you know, whether it's the Rider, whether it's the RS, I think our product engine is extremely strong. And then marketing comes in where you understand who you're selling that product to, right? And talk to those consumers about things that they care about on platforms that they exist. And that's, I think, really the key to growing this segment.
Yeah, in fact, RS is like so popular that even now people ask for it. I saw one of the comment on your profile. Someone was asking for RX, and you said that okay, it's not now. So yeah, that's what the kind of penetration and people's love for the product is. So that's what Puma has achieved. So we usually see any brand, we see that they focus on one particular sector, and they are much more unidirectional in terms of, you know, in which field they want to stand out exactly. But especially, see, with like sports and fitness, it goes hand in hand. And now the lines are even more blurred, because almost all the sports person, they have their own, they are a brand on social media, and they are into fitness as well. So your sports portfolio ranges from sports stars to Bollywood celebrities to influencers. So what is the plan behind it? And is Puma aiming to be more than a sports and a culture brand, or what is it behind?
So I think you're right, because I think we are one of those brands that are not just positioned as a sports brand. I think we have, of course, running and we have running and training products, but we also have, you know, the entire lifestyle segment. We also do motorsport as a segment that, you know, no other brand has, right? And which is a distinct advantage. And again, I think the key really there is to, for each of your offerings, understand who your consumers are, right? Because you have your hardcore runners and, you know, fitness enthusiasts. Then you have sports fans, right? Who are looking for, you know, their team jersey, and, you know, they're excited about those drops. You have sneakerheads who are looking for the next lifestyle drop. We have extremely loyal motorsport buyers who come season on season and buy the latest products, right? And the key is to understand each consumer segment and talk to each consumer segment separately, right? So I think for us, it's, you know, people would assume that marketing is an exercise in creativity, but the reality is it's extremely data driven, right? You spend a lot of time understanding who is buying your products, right? Where they exist, you know, what are their interests? And then you speak to each consumer segment separately. Of course, data makes that possible. Technology makes it easy to reach them where they exist. And I think for us, it's not so much a challenge to be able to position ourselves in each segment, because we're really talking to different sets of consumers. So it's really about understanding for each of our offerings, who is that consumer, and how do we talk to them where they exist about the things that they care about, right? And that's really how, you know, we look at the approach going forward. Marketing is as much about creative execution as it is about data-driven insights and, you know, reaching consumers on mediums that they exist on.
Yeah, sure. So Shreya, although you had half an hour of time for this conversation, but I think we'll stretch for about 5-10 minutes more, because we are getting audience question as well. And you don't have the option to say no, because people love you so much and people love Puma so much. So talking about data and you know, Puma's phenomenal growth over the past couple of years, and especially more towards, you know, increased women customer base. So when you say that your marketing campaigns are heavily data driven, so let's say, for example, Proper Lady campaign, okay?
Right.
So was Proper Lady too planned after keeping in mind the data, after analyzing the data?
Of course. So I think the first step to planning any campaign is really, what objectives do you want to achieve out of it, right? In our case, like you said rightly, we wanted to increase the contribution of our women's business, right? So we started with market research, right? To understand who are these women? What do they care about? What are their interests? And really, if you see a lot of the messaging in the Proper Lady campaign, it was derived out of these insights, right? who are these women really that we want to talk to, right? Are they millennials? Are they working women? Are they college students? What is it that they care about, right? And not just in, you know, the insights that we use to design the campaign, but also the way we disseminated it, right? So where do our consumers exist? We partnered with a bunch of platforms and a bunch of organizations really that, you know, that spoke to that that audience that we were targeting, right? And we curated, again, extremely topical, extremely relevant engagements with that audience. Again, with the idea that if I am curating and creating a campaign for a certain set of women, then I need to talk to them where they exist, right? And so everything from planning the messaging to planning how it was disseminated was a completely data-driven exercise.
So I want you to talk a bit about more the bifurcation of like tier one and tier two, three cities when it comes to especially more on the women's side, because if you see the data still, even in like tier two, tier three cities, girls and women, they don't have access to smartphone as much as compared to men.
So, you know, I would have maybe agreed with that before the pandemic, but I think the one thing that we've seen very interestingly during lockdown and a trend that's continued despite that is there has been exponential growth on online sales from tier two and tier three cities, right? And I think really the lockdown in a lot of ways was sort of that digital revolution that we needed. And so maybe these consumers were shopping offline, maybe they were, you know, going to retail stores. But I think it really changed, again, a lot of stereotypes of how we view Indian consumers, right? Because we were looking at exponential growth from tier two, tier three cities that we had never seen before, right? And it was clear that anybody who felt that the tier two or tier three market was not ready for the digital revolution, was not ready for online shopping, I think we completely shattered those stereotypes with that. And I think the growth that we saw during lockdown from these regions, it's pretty much sustained, right? Those consumers continue to come back to us. They continue to shop from us. We see the same level of sales that we saw during the lockdown. So I think in a lot of senses, a lot of those bifurcations and the demographic assumptions that we used to make, I think have been challenged and sort of changed after the lockdown.
Definitely. So before we jump into taking questions from the audience, I see, of course, marketing is important, but then product plays a very important part, and that the product is like fabulous in case of Puma. And so what, in terms of, if I ask that, if you have to, Shreya, being the head of marketing and strategy, if you have to like sum up in one statement that from the marketing lens, what is the success mantra for Puma India, what that would be?
Okay, so if I had to sum up in one sentence what the success mantra, I think for us really, I think it's about new age marketing, right? It's all about, you know, constantly reinventing ourselves, to keep it fresh and to find ways to reach out to consumers better, right? So whether it's technology, whether it's our content, we don't do the same thing twice, right? If we've done Proper Lady once, we will not do it again. We'll find a new way of, you know, and a new thing to say. And I think that's really it. It's about new age marketing. It's about constantly reinventing ourselves.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure. So, okay, let's jump into the questions we have. So I will be picking up questions. There are a lot. So, oh, nice. So one question to what exactly what you said. What exactly does Shreya mean when she says new age marketing?
All right. I think I answered that, but maybe let me once again repeat. I think it's everything. It's the channels that we choose to talk about, right? So for example, the IG Live was something that we had never done before, and nobody else had really leveraged it that way as well, right? It's content. I think Proper Lady was a fresh take. Before that, we did Sock Them, which was again completely different. And this year, again, in 2021, we'll be looking at a completely, you know, different set of, you know, content that we'll be putting out and campaigns that we'll be driving that we've never done before. It's also about smarter ways of using technology, smarter ways of using data, to ensure that as consumer behavior changes, as consumer preferences change, we also keep up with that, and we make sure that we continue to stay relevant. So that's really what new age marketing is about.
I hope you got your answer. So next, another interesting question is that Indian versus European football in a market like India, where merchandisers don't sell a lot, how much is Puma able to gain from the ISL partnership as compared to the European counterparts?
Sure. You know, I think we are very much a cricket-led nation, but I think even if you look at reports, you know, that are put out on the sports ecosystem, I think you will see that football is very quickly gaining on cricket as well. And especially with this concept of live streaming, right, and OTT platforms, it's very easy to get access to any kind of sporting event, right? And this is what, and we saw this very clearly with the IPL this year. We're also seeing it with the ISL right now, right? Viewership is growing exponentially. So while football may not be, as penetrated as a sport like cricket, I think it is probably the second most important sport in India. And we're seeing that. We're seeing that with our partnerships with BFC. We're seeing that with our partnerships with Mumbai City. I think they have extremely strong, extremely loyal fan bases who are eager for products, they are eager for engagements, they are extremely keen to continue to, you know, engage with us. We recently launched the BFC and the MCFC jerseys also. I don't know how many people, whether you guys saw that, but very locally relevant content, which again got a lot of, built a lot of excitement and got a lot of, reactions from fans. So I think football is definitely going to be a big part of our strategy going forward.
So talking about BFC and Mumbai City FC, so if you see, both are again the metro cities of the country. So if I may ask that, will Puma go towards something like, let's say, for example, Jamshedpur City FC for that matter? So is it like intentional as a brand?
No, it's not intentional at all. I think, BFC and MCFC are one of the strongest teams. But that being said, like I said, football is definitely a focus area for us. And I don't think tier two or tier three was really the deciding factor. I think it was more around the, you know, composition of the teams and their performance. But that being said, I think we're definitely looking to, increase our investment as a brand in football. So I think you should just stay focused, and I'm sure you'll see all of the updates soon.
Oh, wow. So yeah, let's stay tuned, and I'm sure something is coming up on that front. So Shreya, keeping in mind the time commitment which you had, we won't extend this any further. And sure, we would love to wrap up this conversation. Any final advice or any comment to our audience?
I see a lot of questions, and I feel a little bad that I'm not able to answer them. But I hope it was helpful for you guys and interesting. I hope you guys had fun.
Yeah, definitely. We had truly. So thank you, Shreya. Thank you for connecting with the bridge. And let's be hopeful that COVID goes away soon so that all of us are back to our lives. Thank you, Shreya.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. This was a great session. Thanks, guys. Bye.